Moving along. 1 John, turn with me. 1 John. Let's read, if I can find it. Okay, 1 John. I'm sorry, I'm going to make a change. Let's turn a couple pages to 3 John, and we'll read at verse number 11. 3 John, verse number 11. We are continuing justice, but we're very close to the end. I'm trying to bring it all together in a manner that will make us stronger in our spiritual direction and in our biblical knowledge. So 3 John, verse number 11. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God. He that doeth evil hath not seen God. He that doeth good is of God. He that doeth evil hath not seen God. I'm going to teach for a little while on the battleground of good and evil. The battleground of good and evil. Before you're seated, touch your neighbor. Say, this sermon might be for you tonight. Probably so. I'm kind of feeling that way. All right, let's get started. What does John mean? What does John mean when he says that if you do good, you are of God, and if you do evil, you have not seen God? It's an interesting statement because the Bible clearly says no man hath seen God at any time. So John, what are you trying to say when you say, quite startlingly, that if you do evil, you have not seen God? And yet we say no one hath seen God at any time. John is not talking about a literal vision of God. John is talking about perceiving and understanding the work of God, the essence of God. And if you are a evildoer, you have not perceived what it means to be of God. It is possible for people to be quite religious and yet be evildoers. The Pharisees were the enemies of the Lord Jesus Christ. They were very religious, but they were evildoers. They were comfortable in a conspiracy to harm. Now remember, evil is different. It is a unique word, whether used in the Old Testament or New. And as a word, it always has this element of a conspiracy to harm. Sin is missing the mark. Old Testament, New Testament. The word sin always means missing the mark. It's very difficult for us to live our lives without sin, without missing the mark. However, it is not difficult for us to live our lives without evil. It is indeed the will of God that we live our lives without evil. If you have not been with me through 22 weeks of the Bible study on justice, this may be a new idea to you, and you may have to catch up a little bit, but let me move along. So sin is always sin, and evil is always sin, but sin is not always evil. When an individual falls, when they fell short, when they give into temptation, when they err, they may have lost their temper. They may have fallen in a weakness, but they have not entered into a conspiracy to harm anyone. They are a sinner, okay? And as Peter would say, or John, I should say, if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. There's an antidote to sin. The problem is evil is different than sin, and evil is not just missing the mark. Evil is a conspiracy to harm someone else. I'm going to read Romans chapter number 12, verse number 17, and I'm going to read through 21, and I want you to see some of what Paul is getting at here. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Now, again, if you've been with me in this Bible study, this makes very much sense to you. So just try to catch up if you can. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself. Somebody say, avenge not yourself. But rather give place for wrath. What wrath? God's wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine. Who does vengeance belong to? It belongs to God. I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil. Hear this. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Overcome evil with good. Overcome evil with good. Shall I repeat myself? Overcome evil with good. There is a war going on in the world between good and evil. And it's not enough that we fight. It matters how we fight. It's not enough that we disagree with wicked generation. It matters how we disagree. It doesn't matter that we have better understanding and a better way. If we return evil for evil, we have joined the enemy's side. We do not overcome evil with evil. I know your mama told you to fight fire with fire. I know your daddy told you to hit them when they hit you. But as a Christian, we're not following after the good old boy moral system that we grew up with. Well, not in my case. I grew up with perfection, but you get the idea. We do not return evil for evil. We overcome evil with good. Now, we are going to continue through a good bit of scripture here, and so let me try, before I do that, to give you clarity in this passage we read together. Recompense no man evil for evil. Recompense simply is a kind of King Jamesian word to refer to giving back. So it's just to return. Someone hits you, you hit them back. Don't do that. Don't return evil for evil. And this word avenge means to vindicate, punish, protect, defend. The Lord would have you know, avenge not yourself. Vengeance comes from the root of avenge, and it means the same thing, but in this case, vengeance is the Lord. So it's not our job to fight evil with evil, violence with violence, dislike with dislike, anger with anger, hatred with hatred, gossip with gossip, stuck-up nose with stuck-up nose. You don't compliment my shoes, I don't compliment your shoes. No. The Lord will repay. The Lord will do this. This is one of the most difficult parts of serving the Lord for all of us. Because as we seek to serve the Lord, it becomes more our understanding to see justice and to recognize justice, what would have been the right thing to be done, what would have been the right thing to have been said. And you, as you come to understand justice, you will see more the weaknesses of others because you have come through that. And there is this great temptation to have a dismissive, condescending attitude toward people who haven't arrived at where you are in biblical understanding, in kind of biblical truth. And as a result, you will have this increasingly great urge to correct people because after all, you know. The problem is not that you know. You may, in fact, know. If you've served the Lord all your life, if you've served the Lord with diligence and zeal, as we all should, in many cases, you may know. And it may just nearly kill you not to correct, because after all, you know. But the problem is this. Unless you have a trust relationship with that person whom you would correct, there is no chance for discipleship. And this is where a lot of times people who know, we get wrong-footed. It's not that we don't know. We do know, you see. I can get on social media and look at people's, and that guy's, my wife's going to be mad at him. That's none of this guy's business. Why is this lady saying that? She just revealed a bad attitude. I can see, you can see, we've spent our whole lives, at least three times a week, opening the greatest book that was ever written and applying it to our heart. And if you can do that without growing, you're crazy. So you've grown and you see. But the problem is, without a trust relationship, there is no discipleship. And so we oftentimes know, but we cannot correct because we haven't trust trust in place. We can see injustice, and we can begin to feel as though it is our job to start correcting, to start judging. And it's not necessarily from a desire to have power, sometimes, but a lot of times, no. It's not from a desire to, you know, make me in charge of something, sometimes, but not necessarily. It often is just the case that you know better. And you see somebody doing something that you know better, and you feel like you're helping them. But if you don't have a trust relationship, so hear me, discipleship is more about trust than it's about truth. Now, if that shocked you, good. That means you'll pay attention for the next 3 minutes. You see, my game is tight. Discipleship is more about trust than about truth. What do I mean by that? If you go to the highest levels of biblical scholarship, you end up in small book-filled rooms with people who have spent their whole life studying deep into the various instances of language and translation and theological dilemmas, and they've spent their whole life, and they have PhDs and LLDs, and as the preachers used to say before they went out of style, and they're all driving LTDs. Nobody drives an LTD anymore. At least if you do, God bless you. We'll take up an offering for you later, but... And you have this small group of scholars. It has been my privilege to sit in rooms with brilliant, brilliant men who have spent their whole life studying the Word of God. And because it's a safe space, they're able to talk about things that they see somewhat different in Scripture. And they have respect for each other, and they learn, and iron sharpens iron. How many of you know that's to be true? Okay, and so here you have these men, and you have men of profound learning, and you know what they're arguing about? They're arguing about technical things like the tenses of a verb in the Greek. You understand what I'm saying? They're not arguing about, well, bless God, come out from, no. They are talking about technical things, and they're really trying to get it right, okay? And there's a small room. Most of us can't sit in there on that conversation. Most of us can't read it in the Greek or read it in the Hebrew, okay? And they will have profound disagreements about things, and you'll sit there and you'll think, man, I don't know who to go with. All these guys are smarter than me. All these guys have got more degrees than me. All of these, if you haven't been in this room, trust me, it's just because you haven't been there. It's going on all the time. And you think, who do I go with? And you don't know who to go with. But let me tell you, all the friends and family of Scholar A go with Scholar A's interpretation. All the friends and family of Scholar B go with Scholar B's interpretation. And all the friends and family of Scholar C go with Scholar C's because they don't know. But when in doubt, they go with trust. They may not have a religious degree of any type, but trust. You know, it's not just people who get the Bible right who make the disciples. One of the criticisms that the Lord made of the Pharisees is that they would move heaven and earth to make one disciple. And when they're finally done, he's twice the son of hell they were. And you thought I just was blunt. Let me tell you, Jesus could be a bit terse. Without trust, there is no discipleship. So we know and we see injustice. We see people making mistakes. If I had a dollar for every time I've sat in a room or in my office and had someone give me their life plans and thought to myself, this is not going to end well. You get the idea. But unless there is trust, there is no discipleship. And so we oftentimes begin to get involved in things on a judgment level that is not our jurisdiction. It's not because we want to be bad people. It's not because we want to be in charge. It's just we know better and we would never make that mistake. And yet, I see that little error, and you have seen this too, progress all the way into schisms of religion, into church splits, into people who were once sincere are now evildoers. They have a conspiracy to harm others, and they do it in the name of the Lord. You see, we don't want to make this mistake. And the first path is going to be us humbling ourselves and acknowledging what we can get involved with and what we cannot get involved with. I have seen so many people, I traveled a long time, and oftentimes a pastor would bring my wife and I in to do a special event, and they would be fighting something in their church. Pastors had just gone through a lot of trouble, and they're trying to get some momentum back, and they bring in an evangelist, and you're there and you're preaching, and you don't know all the details. It would be inappropriate for the pastor to give you all the details. But the thing is you're not stupid, and you're at the church every day anyway. And so you start figuring out, man, they just had a storm come through here. And I've seen good people who got so off track, and I've told you guys some stories in the past. I'm not going to do it tonight. They got so off track that they essentially ended up as an evildoer, and they started with good intentions. So we acknowledge there is a battle between good and evil. Yes, the Bible shows us this. The Bible teaches this. I want you to see evil in the efforts of Lucifer when he walks into the garden of God's perfection and begins to tempt Eve. He's not a sinner. He's an evildoer. He is in a conspiracy to harm someone else. It wasn't just pride now. Now it is evil. And in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve do not have the knowledge of good and evil. All they are living in the essence of their created existence. In other words, God made things perfect. God made a perfect garden. God made them perfect. And they are living out who they are. They are of good. Why? God is good. We read 3 John 6. If anyone does good, he is what? Of God. Somebody say, of God. It's not a revelation. When you do good, you are of God. You are a part of the kingdom of heaven on earth. Do you see? When you do good, you are not, I saw the light. No, you are of God. Why? You are his hands and his feet. You are the work of God in the earth. Okay, so if you do good, you are of God. Adam and Eve in their essence, in their original creation, are good. And as a result, it is not their nature to harm. It is their nature to help. They are of God. And so Satan comes along and Satan promises you eat of this fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will know both good and evil. Satan wants to do them harm by making them allies of harm, to teach them to harm and to see one another in a competitive, evil way. And so they now have the capacity, and the Lord sees him and sees Adam and Eve's change, and they realize they now have the capacity to not just do good, that was their essence, but now they have the capacity to do evil, to hurt, to harm, and their children live out the excesses of their own moral change. And that's usually the way it is. The moral change that you allow in your life will be lived out to its excess in your children. And so Cain kills Abel. You guys with me in the scripture? Cain kills Abel. The grandson of Cain is the first one to fashion weapons of war. And now you have this contest and this warfare and taking and the like. And so you see the battle of good and evil. Joseph, in his own life, his own calling, his own destiny, fights a battle between good and evil. And even though his brethren had done evil to him, a conspiracy to harm, what does he pay them in recompense? He overcomes evil with good. When the spies enter the promised land and they come back and they, all of them, except for two, Joshua and Caleb, they all say, we're not able. The Bible says they brought an evil report. Why evil? Their report did harm to the people of God. David fought a battle in himself between good and evil. In 1 Samuel 25, 21, the Bible says, now David had said, surely in vain I have kept all that this fellow hath in the wilderness, so that nothing was missed of all that pertaineth unto him, and he hath requited me evil for good. Paul fought a battle between good and evil in his ministry, between benefiting and hurting. He had a ministry that was often contested, much more than any of the apostles who had the obvious sanction of the Lord upon them by having been with Jesus as one of the 12. Paul had not that, and Paul spends much of his writings defending himself, acknowledging to people that he was not of the 12, but he had been called expressly by Jesus Christ on the Damascus Road. He will receive criticism for this. He will be in danger from friends, people who should be on his side. It would have been easy to see how he was disliked, mistrusted, he once persecuted. the people of God. But even within himself, Paul is not going to deceive himself about this battle. And he says this in Romans 7:21, I find then a law that when I do good, evil is present in me. He doesn't use the word for sin. He uses the word for evil. Evil, remember, is the conspiracy to harm. When someone hurts you, the most natural thing in the world is for you to find a way to hurt them back. When someone makes fun of you, the most natural thing in the world is for you to find a way to make fun of them back. When someone in somehow is dismissive of you or condescending toward you, and it hurts, and you go home and you feel somehow low-rated or stupid or in some way unvalued, the hardest thing in the world is to forgive them and go back and return good for evil. But that is the cross we all said we wanted to carry. We all said we wanted to be like Jesus. We all said we want to be changed. Boy, it's quiet. We all said we wanted to walk this way. We all said we could carry this cross. It's time to shut up and carry it. Amen. The battle between good and evil is always ongoing. Hebrews 5 and 14 gives us this passage, but strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. This is something that should happen within all mature believers. We, all of us, should recognize the potential in ourselves to be a worker of both good and evil. If the Apostle Paul, after having written most of the New Testament, can make himself vulnerable for all history to judge and say that within himself he has evil warring against the good, there's a battle within himself to choose the good, to be the right, to follow in the path of Christ, how much more should we, all of us, be willing to accept that there is a struggle with within us. Every time we're hurt, every time somebody in some way injures us, there's a tendency for us to return evil for evil. It is the way of the flesh. It is the way of the fallen history of mankind, and we, all of us, must war against that. Can I have an amen? Amen. Remember, sin is not evil. Sin is a form of evil. Not all sin is evil, but all evil is sin. Sin is the part of that. Evil is the part of sin that wants to hurt somebody. We want to conspire to damage them. We want to conspire to make them look silly or stupid or in some way get them back. How do we, if we admit, and I believe we do, if we admit there's a contest of good and evil in the earth, and we want to be of God, yes, we want to be of God. We don't want to just have a label. Everybody has a label. We want to be of God. So that means we have to live a certain way. Yes, that means we have to humble ourselves with a certain willingness and commitment. We all want to be good. So what does that mean? How do we fight evil? Let's admit there's evil in the earth. And furthermore, let's admit there is a law in our own history and our own nature that will war against the good. And we can have bloody hands where we hurt others in some misguided effort even to do good. We can harm. I've never seen a church split where one side admitted they were wrong. I've never seen church confusion in a church where one side admitted, hey, we're the evil side. I've never seen destruction brought to a fellowship of churches where one side said, hey, we're the bad guys over here. No. Everybody thinks they're right, and they enter a conspiracy of harm. I, as a believer, I, as a minister, I have slipped into conversations that, looking back, I don't know that that wasn't anything more than a conspiracy to harm somebody. And I have to acknowledge that, or I won't be a repentant person. I have to acknowledge that, or the Lord won't trust me with souls. Let me tell you, God won't send you souls if he can't trust you with them. He died for them. He loves them. When God can trust us with new people, he'll send us new people. Someone was saying a few weeks back about how many new people there were, and I immediately said, yes, if God can trust us with them, he'll send them to us. He draws. Yeah, we market, we pass out, we testify, but he draws. And when he can trust us with people, I'm afraid of churches where there's no new people. I wonder why. Do they have bloody hands? There should be more new people. Boy, I'm off in the weeds here, aren't I? Come on, this is what's in my heart. This is where God, if God can trust us, he'll use us. But he's not going to send the vulnerable into people with bloody hands. He's not going to give the new believer to a group of people who is in a conspiracy in some manner, even well-intentioned, whatever, a conspiracy of evil to do harm, to hurt in any way. And I thank God that this church does not have that in this culture. This church has never had that in its culture. This church never will have it in its culture unless y'all run me off, and good luck trying. You understand what I'm saying? We've never had that. You can have it over my dead body. You see what I'm saying? We are not going to have bloody hands. I want God's best for you. I want God. You know what I tell all the new people that come to my first steps? This is a church that'll love you. This is a church that'll support you. This is a church that'll make a place for you. We're on your side. When you're blessed, we're blessed. When you're anointed, we're anointed. This is a safe place. All right, so let me move along here. Let's talk about this. I'm doing good on time. Has anyone noticed? It's like 8:20. Let's see how good I do for the next 20 minutes. So we admit there's this battlefield between good and evil, yes? And we admit it doesn't just happen out there with others, but it happens in here, yes? Okay, so I want to give you some truths that you can hold on to in your war between good and evil. Truths that you can hold on to in your work of spiritual ministry and purpose. These are truths that you can hold on. And the number one that I want to give you, the very first one that I want you to get a hold of, and I want you to put it on the refrigerator door of your heart. You know, that's where you're going all the time to get Oreos and milk. You put it on the refrigerator door of your heart. This is fundamental, it's absolute, and it is the very first principle of the battle between good and evil in the earth and in our own hearts. Number one, evil cannot destroy you. I'm going to say it again because I expected to get a little more excitement than that. Evil cannot destroy you. 1 John 4:4, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The devil cannot destroy you. Whoever has hurt your feelings, they can't take away your birthday. That's in the Greek. That's actually in the Greek. No, I'm just teasing. So the enemy cannot destroy you. The person who may have made you feel unvalued or hurt you in some way, they cannot destroy you. The person who refused to include you because they just wanted the three people in their close friends clique, and when you came in, they got mad, they cannot destroy you. The devil cannot destroy you, and he's the most impressive of all God's creations. He cannot destroy you. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You have to believe that. Or you'll always be intimidated that the rock concert's bigger than the worship service. You'll always be intimidated because the unbelievers have more money than the believers. You'll always be intimidated because those who are outside will always outnumber those who are inside, you see. But if you can see that God has structured this creation in such a way that evil cannot destroy the good. They could threaten to take your life in persecution, but it wouldn't affect you none at all because to live is Christ and to die is gain. They cannot destroy the good. Number two, you can, however, be destroyed by evil. The devil can't destroy you. The world can't destroy you. The neo-atheists of this era cannot destroy you. The doubting Thomases and the unbelievers can't destroy you, but you can be destroyed. The only one who can destroy you through evil is you. And number three, so number one is evil cannot conquer you. Number two is you can be conquered, but it's up to you. And number three, no one's actions can destroy you. It is only your evil reactions that can destroy you. No one's evil action can destroy you. It's only if you allow your reactions to be evil that you can be destroyed. So hear me, the only one who can destroy you is you. Evil is a risk, and evil can destroy us. But the only evil that can destroy us is that evil that we allow to live within us. And when we lose the battle between good, helping people, and evil, hurting people, we are destroyed by evil. So I want to say it again. Whenever we lose the battle between good, helping people, and evil, hurting people, we are destroyed by evil. Good overcomes evil. As long as you keep doing more good, when evil comes your way, you cannot be destroyed. As long as you respond to evil with good, evil can never destroy you. Doing good has no limit. Evil has a limit, and a day will come when evil is called to a final accounting, but we are the only ones who can allow evil to destroy us when evil subsumes us and we become a worker of evil. This is how Satan works. Satan cannot destroy Eve. All Satan can do is get Eve to buy in. And this is how evil works. Oftentimes, churches that are highly zealous, we can, in our understanding, kind of be tribal, effectively tribal rather than spiritual. And what I mean by that is we begin to develop these hard lines of insiders versus outsiders, church people versus unbelievers. And then we begin to think, not perhaps intentionally, but it can happen, that us insiders can do no wrong and those outsiders can do no right. And therefore, when they hurt us, we're justified to, in some way, hurt them back, do you see? Because we are good, but we can be workers of evil when we enter into a conspiracy to harm anyone else. And this is how Satan works. He cannot get you to be destroyed by evil, but he can get you to join the evil parade. He cannot destroy you with evil. He can only get you to buy in. And so here comes the progression. And I'm almost done. I'm going to end with this. I want you to think about it. Here is the progression of self-destruction. Remember, evil cannot destroy you, right? The devil cannot destroy you, right? But we can destroy ourselves. And it is a self-destruction when we are converted by evil. Now, if there's one thing Christian folks understand, we understand conversion, right? You were this, now you're this. You were that, now you're the other, okay? You were Brother Nathan, now you're Adam Cruz. I mean, Adam Hodge. Adam Cruz works too. Just having fun for all our good beloveds here. Okay, so here we go. We understand conversion, and evil wins when we are converted to evil. It is always a conversion of self-destruction. Almost done. Stay with me. First comes outside evil. Okay? Can the outside evil destroy you? Somebody say no. But it comes to you, right? Evil comes to you. You're the only one who can destroy you. However, if the evil can convert you into being an evil doer by responding in kind, then you have rendered evil for evil. The only option we have to fight evil is to do good, to pour on the good. When they bring the evil, you bring the good. Let me remind you, your reaction to evil is what really can destroy you. Not the evil, but your reaction to evil. So let me say this, no one can destroy the church but the church. When we are converted into a conspiracy to harm, that can destroy a church. It won't matter that we have a churchified name, not us, but you get the idea, I'm speaking rhetorically. I mean, it could happen to us too. It won't matter that people see your religious label. If you are a worker of evil, then you have become what you claim to hate, and your label will not save you. There's going to be people at the judgment who say, did not we do all these works in your name? And Jesus say, never knew you. The label will not save us. Church history is full of examples of the so-called church doing evil in the name of righteousness. Do you see? A conspiracy to harm and calling it for the best of reasons, but the truth is, it is just evil. If we can't be destroyed by the devil, but we can be destroyed by our own reaction or being converted to evil, then we have to worry about the reaction we have to evil in our life. So let me shock some of you, because that's kind of fun. The Bible does not say to overcome evil with prayer. I'm all for prayer. Prayer is powerful. None of us pray too much. But that's not the word that's used in the Bible. It says the way you overcome evil is doing good. The Bible doesn't say we overcome evil with Bible study. Bible study is good. None of us do enough of it. It doesn't say we overcome through Bible study. We overcome by doing good. We don't overcome evil by meditating. I'm meditating on the Lord. That's awesome. But if you're fighting evil, you need to get out of your isolation and go do good. Because that is how we overcome evil. Evil's going to come to you. Remember, I talked about this. Evil is attracted to good. You do something awesome, evil's going to show up. If tomorrow our church had an amazing revival, evil would be right on the heels. There would be people who didn't believe it. They thought that we didn't. I was over there and their music wasn't even very good. There would be people that would be jealous of it. There would be people that didn't trust it. There would be people that didn't trust us. There would be people who really wanted to bring us back down to size. And what's all that happened? We had a great revival. What's wrong with a great revival? I don't know, but it attracts evil. If you had a breakthrough in your life, say you started a Bible study or a small group ministry of some type, and it just blew up. It was just awesome. And I promise you, on the heels of the good would come the evil, because the devil hates the work of God in the earth, and he can't leave paradise alone. How then do we respond? That's the key. If we are converted by the serpent's visit to paradise, we respond evil for evil. So evil's going to come. The first thing is evil comes from the outside. The next comes the challenge of the heart. Are we going to render evil for evil? So another church said, I don't believe those people out there even believe the truth. I just think they're a bunch of carnal bums. Y'all didn't know you were a bunch of carnal bums. You just wanted to have a revival, right? And you had a great revival, but they're not happy about that. So because they mean well, but they have made mistakes, they're now talking about you, okay? They don't believe blah, blah, blah. And you started a small group, and now you have 30 people in your house, and you know, it's out of control, and half of them are new, and you know what, someone else who's failing and doesn't like it, and so they're talking about you. I don't even think she prayed. I think all they do is hand out M&Ms. That's not biblical. Okay, the good attracted the evil. So here comes the evil. If you are converted by the evil and you respond in kind, well, let me tell you about so-and-so. She's just an idiot. She was born an idiot. She was raised by idiots. She's been idiot from teens to her 50s. And although she looks like she's in her 60s, she's an idiot. She can't fix it. You might as well ignore her. A Mack truck had hit her and it'd be a blessing to the church. Now, what have you just done? You were hurt. You were criticized. But you've just rendered evil for evil. Instead of converting anybody to God, you were converted to evil by a serpent in your paradise. And now you're rendering evil for evil. I pray at some point in my walk with God that I can have enough spiritual discipline and godly faith that when evil comes, I can smile and say, thank you, devil, for the compliment. Oh, but I'm a long way from that. So first comes outside evil. Now, number two comes the question of the heart. How are you going to respond? I know very sincere people that made a decision wrong and they split a church. I know very sincere ministers that made a decision and they split an organization. I know very sincere people who thought they were doing the right thing, but what they did is enter into a conspiracy of harm that ultimately divided, destroyed, and like a thief, only came to steal, to kill, and to destroy, a conspiracy of harm. So outside evil, number one. Number two, question of the heart. How are you going to respond? Number three, if this is the progression of evil, if you make the wrong decision and you in your heart decide to fight fire with fire, to return evil for evil, criticism with criticism, insult to insult, the next step for you is spoken evil. You now, having made a decision in your heart, will begin to speak evil. You will begin to whisper evil. You will begin to say what you don't like about that person. You will begin to speak evil. That's the third step. Instead of overcoming evil with good, you now have been converted by evil and you are speaking evil. And finally, and this is the most dangerous phase, this is the most dangerous phase, you now enter into a fellowship of evil. I'm sad too, darling. All this talk about evil's got me nervous. The fourth step is you enter into a fellowship of evil. This is so dangerous because I have very rarely seen people come back from a fellowship of evil. Once you get your three friends, all of whom don't like David Martin, come on, let's get real. I mean, not about David Martin, but you get the idea. It'd be pretty hard not to like Brother Martin. You get the idea. I mean, if you dislike David Martin, you're crazy. You should probably meet that Mack truck we were talking about earlier, you know. just fun. Peace. Chill. So, okay. What was I talking about? Ah, fellowship of evil. Leave it to Adam Hodge to know about a fellowship of evil. I have almost never seen people come back from a fellowship of evil. First came evil into your life. Number two, there was a question of your heart. How are you going to respond? You chose to return evil for evil, criticism for criticism, insult for insult. The next thing that happens is you begin to speak that evil. The Bible talks about people who speak evil. I've spent 22 weeks talking about that in the scripture, people speaking evil. And the final step is a fellowship of evil. And it is so dangerous because now you have people who look at you doing evil and tell you you're doing good. That's the final deception. You and your three friends, your four friends who don't like the way Brother Nathan does Wednesday night, or you don't like the way Sister Megan does the music, or you don't like the way that, oh, shall we go on? You don't like, you and your friends, you sit around and you enter into, not you guys are all perfect, but random strangers sit around and enter into a conspiracy to harm. And you look in each other's eyes and you say you're good. That's the final deception. I have almost never seen. I've seen people destroy good churches because of a fellowship of evil. I've seen this church almost get to that level when there was a group of men who did not like the way things were. This is before I got here, although, you know, I'm sure I'm open for any criticism you're in the mood for. But before I got here, and they began to systematically enter into a critique, a fellowship of critique and criticism. And it's not just this church. There's many churches that have gone through this. Evil comes, it's going to come. It's attracted to good. The serpent is going to come to paradise. He hates anything that's good. We respond. How are we going to respond? It's a question of the heart. Evil came. We're going to overcome evil with good, or are we going to overcome evil with evil? If we fail that test, we slip into speaking evil. We now have we're saying negative things. We're trying to hurt with words. And finally, we find, you can be in a church of 2,000 people, but if you don't like somebody, you'll find the other two people in the church who don't like that person. And you will get together. It's like chipmunks. Me, I want a hula hoop. And you and your friends. Okay, not you guys. You guys are perfect. So if you are in, And I'm going to say this very seriously, and I'm going to say this at this moment, not as Brother Nature friend. I'm going to say this as a man of God. If you are in a conspiracy of evil, and you have a certain set of friends that you get together with, and you chop, and you hurt, and you kill, you need to humble yourself. You need to find an altar. And you need to say, please, God, purify this tendency within me to be a part of a conspiracy of evil, to harm anybody, to have bloody hands, to hurt anybody. Because if you don't do that, you will get with your friends and you'll find a way to explain this Bible study away. And you won't even know that you are the face of the serpent in the garden. Thankfully, we don't have anybody like that here, but someone far away will see this video and they'll say, I was saved. Let's all stand. I want to overcome evil with good. I want to overcome evil with good. Lord Jesus, we stand before you. We acknowledge your presence in our midst, in our hearts. And Lord Jesus, we are asking to have pure hearts. We're asking to have pure minds. We're asking to have pure spirits. Lord Jesus, there will be evil that comes against your people. There will be evil that comes against workers of good. But Lord Jesus, we are going to overcome evil with good. We are going to overcome the attack of the enemy with the positive force of the Holy Ghost and know that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And Lord Jesus, I'm praying your blessing upon your people. I'm praying spiritual maturity that gives them confidence to stand in the path of spiritual challenge and choose to do the good, to say the good, to preach the good, to pray the good. In Jesus' name, I pray. By the promises of your word, by the authority of your name, we claim it today in Jesus' name. And somebody help me praise him right now. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord.
Thank you for watching First Church Charlotte. If you're in the Charlotte, North Carolina area, come join us at 4929 North Sharon Amity Road at the corner of Shamrock Drive. Sunday mornings at 9 and 11 a.m. and Bible study Wednesdays at 7:30 p.m. Online, find us at firstchurchclt.com or like us on Facebook or Twitter. We hope to see you soon. Come worship with us.